You know, there's nothing like cracking that cellophane and pulling that record out. It just smells great.
Welcome to Boz Mayhem Hour.
Nonstop hardcore energy.
I love the show, guys. You're awesome.
Unlike any other.
With your host, John the Bod, a.k.a. The Bodfather.
Man, this stuff rocks.
This is Chase from Awaken, and you're listening to Boz Mayhem Hour.
The views and opinions of the guests do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of Boz Mayhem Radio Network, its staff, affiliates, or sponsors. Parental discretion is advised. Welcome to Boz Mayhem Radio Network.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Boz Mayhem Hour. I'm your host, John the Bod, a.k.a. The Bod Father. As always, I'm bringing you guys and gals awesome interviews. But before we get into our interview today, I'm going to do a little tribute. As you all know, some of these interviews are pre-recorded, and this interview is coming to you pre-recorded on 9/11, 19 years of the heinous act that happened 19 years ago on 9/11. Innocent people lost their lives and many families torn apart on this day, never to be the same. I can only imagine the pain they feel still. Prayers for those families and for everybody who lost their lives that shouldn't have been lost. Never forget this day. Never, ever forget this day. And please help one another. We're living in some really trying times right now. It's really ugly right now with some things. So we all need to get our acts together, come together, and realize that we should help one another. So let's never forget 9/11 and move forward and never forget these families and stuff. So today on Boz Mayhem Hour, I would like to welcome Chase Sludge Regan of Awaken. Awaken have released their debut single, Behemoth. For their upcoming record, Monsters and Machines, via InGrooves, that's coming out hopefully soon. The single is now getting some waves internationally, so we're going to be talking to Chase about all this stuff. So, man, how you doing, and welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, man. Doing really, really good. I appreciate you taking the time to do this interview, man. Any time we can talk to anybody, we definitely love to do it, so I appreciate it.
What have you been up to during the pandemic, other than talking and promoting the new debut single, Behemoth, for your upcoming record, Monsters and Machines, via InGrooves?
Well, besides doing all of that, which, I mean, anybody who's been in the band knows that can be a full-time job in itself doing what we're doing. But on top of that, we, thankfully, the four of us have been blessed enough to be able to keep our jobs through this. I know a lot of people weren't so fortunate. We were, so we've been still steady working, working on the album. And then, of course, you know, we got a group of musicians, so we work on many other things. I know I am a sound engineer, this main sound engineer for the church that I attend, and that keeps me busy with multiple services and work on recording music locally in my area. Dustin as well, I mean, working on the album. He's working on some other music projects. And we stay pretty busy through it.
You wanted a song that would make an impact, grab someone's attention. Why the single Behemoth? And were there another song that could have been the debut single, possibly, that Behemoth knocked out, maybe?
There definitely was. Well, there could have been two or three other songs that could have been the debut single, for sure, off this record. This one in particular, with the lyrical story behind it that Chad had, and honestly just the powerful riff that Dustin came out with, was just one of those songs where, I mean, we're a hard rock band, and we want to let people know that we've got some noise to make, and this one seemed like the right one to be able to grab somebody's attention by. A lot of the record that's coming out, of course, we'll be letting you guys know as soon as that happens, after we get a couple more singles out to you. This record's got several songs on it that are a little more medium tempo, not quite as heavy as Behemoth, but Behemoth was one of the heavier songs on the record that we felt was good to grab people's attention. Again, you know, there's two or three other ones that could have, but for what we're dealing with right now, and especially with the message of the record, we felt that this song was a good song to start off with.
Now, this pandemic has threw a twist in everybody's schedule that they had planned for 2020. Were you guys a little nervous releasing the single Behemoth in this crazy pandemic, you know, without being able to tour right now? Was this something that kind of crossed your guys' mind to say, like, well, let's just go ahead and do it and sit back and wait, or what was the plan?
Honestly, when it comes to us, we've been, and especially with me, before Awaken, I joined actually Awaken not too long ago. I was a professional musician for many years in another band that's still a professional tour. Actually, they're on tour right now. They're signed with Rock Fest Records called The Protest. We've been in the industry for a few years, so we kind of know what to expect, what things to do, and seeing what's been going on with the pandemic. You know, on the business side of things, we knew that touring and playing is going to be down for a while. In a lot of ways that bands are still making waves and keeping fans intrigued is by releasing more music and doing online videos for the fans. So when it came to the decision of releasing the single, we really had no qualms about it. We knew, hey, you know what? Fans want new music. We want to get music out there to them. Let's get it rolling. And decided to throw it out there.
I don't want to throw like a damper into everybody's hopes and everything, but I just don't see this being feasible in 2021 early. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I don't mean that in a bad way. There's so many things that we just don't believe right now or can't believe right now because we don't know what's going to go on.
That's very, very true. There are some people out there that are doing shows and ways that they can, be it outside shows that have been happening a lot during the summer. I think we'll see a decline in shows for bands through the fall and winter because, you know, you're kind of left to indoor venues only, and with what's going on, you know, people are still, you know, kind of scared, don't really know what they should be doing or not doing, and there's a little bit of chaos, and so I do think, you know, it may be a little bit before we get back to the norm. I believe, and I want to continue to believe, that once we get through this fall and winter, I'm the person that believes that, hey, you know what, let's put the facts where facts are, and COVID's never going away, and when you look at the real honest things, it's getting better because it's, you know, all the new cases have been far less severe than what it was back in, you know, February, March, April. So we're handling it good as a nation. You know, we're doing what we can. We're coming back, and I'm believing that come springtime 2021, we'll be able to start seeing more normal shows, more bigger things like that. Especially a lot of it comes through our leadership as well. As long as our, you know, leadership's statewide, federal-wise, or looking out for the best of everybody and trying to make sure everybody can go back to a normal life. I think, well, you know, I have high hopes that we'll be able to get back to some kind of normal, something reminiscent to that.
What about the streaming side of this? Have you guys took advantage of that? Because now I think this is like an even platform for all the bands, and some are taking advantage of the streaming deal live.
Yes, we have. I think we've released three or four. Something that Chad and Dustin have been doing is doing acoustic versions of songs from previous records. We've got some plans on not just some other acoustic songs, but possibly some acoustic covers that fans might like to hear. And we've talked about, and like other bands have done, actually I just got done watching last night, a big favorite band of mine is Fitbird King. They put on an awesome, awesome two-hour live concert on streaming. I think it's a phenomenal platform that fans are really capitalizing on and utilizing. I think it's what we're trying to do for the fans here in the near future.
What's impressed or excited you the most about working on this new album, Monsters and Machines? If anything, if you could talk about just a little bit, is there anything that's stood out or impressed you possibly?
For this record, I'll be 100% honest. I came in when the record was done. I met Dustin and Chad and Jimmy around 2012. They recorded their debut album, The Narrow Door, with the same producer we did when I was in The Protest, our record, Game Changer, with, and that was Travis Wyrick, based out of Knoxville, Tennessee. So we kind of hooked up together, and at that time, the band I was in, The Protest, we had started headlining our own tours across the country, and we had met up with Awaken and did a co-headlining tour together back in 2012 called the Through the Darkness Tour, and that's how we met. We became real good friends, but more than that, I became a huge fan of the band. I mean, I've kept up with every record they did, you know, the Echoes and Reflections album, and then one they released about a little over a year ago, Face of a Ghost, I thought was phenomenal. You know, I'm a fan. You know, I joked about them when we first got together because they had lost their bass player and said, hey, man, we don't really want anybody else but you to join the band and play bass. And it was no-brainer. I was like, yeah, absolutely. I kind of felt like Robert Trujillo in Metallica's position. You know, it's like, I'm a fan, you know, joining up with some dudes that, you know, yeah, you're my friends, but I love your music. You know, I rock out to it. So they had already had the record wrote, and I'd heard a couple things, you know, prior to them even asking me to join, and I was so excited about it and couldn't wait. And then Dustin who does primarily all the music writing, called up and said, "Hey man, let's all meet together now that you joined, and I want you, let's do an album listen through for this new record." And came out to his house. He's got a studio at his house, and he was like, "Hey man, if there's anything you think needs changed, let me know. We'll make changes. And even before we take this thing to print, let's make the final changes we want to the band." And I thought that was pretty cool. I even said, "Hey, how much do you want me to say?" Because he knows I've been in music for pretty much my whole life. And so that level of respect was great. For me, it was awesome because it was like, man, I didn't really write, but you gave me the opportunity to step in here and contribute. I definitely contributed a bit to the record. Mainly a lot of things was as far as mixing, on several songs, because I've been mixing and producing and engineering for bands live and in studio for decades. Little things I would hear about, "Hey, let's fix this, and this will make this guitar pop a little bit more." And or I might have, a couple songs I heard a melody of Chad, like, "Hey, why don't you try this?" Little tiny things that he would let me go through and do. And so I got to put my little parts in here and there. And so for the writing process, for me, it was kind of like doing the fine tuning instead of the full writing process as you normally would. So with what I got to contribute, man, it was a blast. I was excited to be in a room with my friends, but again, as a fan of the band, I was sitting there going, "Oh yeah, you want my input? I keep forgetting that." So it was exciting for me to kind of do something a little bit different than what I'm used to. And I'm sure come the time to do the next album, we'll all come together and write a little bit more, because I wrote predominantly for the band I was in prior. So it was a cool little experience for me as far as the writing process to come on the back end and kind of throw in some, final touches.
Are there any tracks standing out more to you than any right now on the album? If you can talk about it just a little bit. I mean, I know that you came in on this a late, but are there any that stick out for you possibly?
Oh, any? Quite possibly all, to be honest with you. I don't want to, again, brag as a band member, but I will brag as a fan since I've heard this record. Not many records. There's not many. I mean, I've been a musician my whole life. Music's everything to me. There's very few albums that I can put on and listen to start to finish and never get bored. And not saying that there's some, records where I'll listen to a band like, okay, I might skip a song. Not saying that the song's bad. It's just the song doesn't jump out to me, like the rest of the album does. For this album, Dustin and Chad did a phenomenal job, and every song sticks out. I mean, I listen to the whole album every time from the beginning to the very end. I'm absolutely in love with this thing. But there are a couple that stick out more than most. One of them actually will be our next single that comes out October 9th called Stained Glass. When I heard that song and we were listening, we had talked about, hey, what's the next single? How do we want to do the orders of the single? And they had another song off the record planned for the second single. I was like, guys, no, trust me. This one right here, this is Stained Glass needs to be the next single. It's really going to grab people, especially with the hook and the music of it, and that one's probably the one I'm most excited about coming out next, Stained Glass.
Do you know, Chase, that there was a song that you guys were working on this album that ended up sounding different or maybe took a major turn than what it first started out as?
I know there's a song called The River on the record that had some changes because it was, had some older lyrics and music that they had before. Same with Stained Glass. I would say in that aspect of what might be different, there is a song on the record called Voices that I think is going to absolutely surprise everybody because it's a definite turn than what most people might expect from the band or our style in general.
What do you bring to this band that may have been missing, possibly not knocking anybody else? I'm just asking, what have you brought to this band that may have been missing maybe?
The only thing, honestly, because the writing's so good and the talent is so good, the only thing that I would say that I brought to the band that's missing would be the business side of the band. That was something that, in my previous band, that I handled. When we came together in the protest, because I actually recorded those guys' first three CDs when they were back in middle school and high school, because they're, their families, friends of my family up in Indiana. And when I joined, that was the discussion was, hey, what do we want to do this professionally? Is this something we really want to do and make it full time? I said yes, and I had the contacts, I had the business experience, and did everything I could to put the grind down, and took us from a band that was just playing local shows to touring nationally. And that's what I bring to this band is I've got the contacts, I've got the experience, and the know-how on how to really move the band further business-wise.
Yeah, and I want everybody to understand that if you want to be a major touring band that finally gets that great record deal one day, you're going to have to put some time and effort in it, some sweat and some blood, some tears, definitely a lot of tears, and a lot of road burn, because it's not easy. It's not easy at all.
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not. You know, I work right now currently as a supervisor for UnitedHealthcare, and I do the band. And I can tell you firsthand experience from my time in the protest when it comes to the business side, that I worked more hours doing that than I do now, mm-hmm. Working full-time for a job. Because it is. It's hard. Travis Wyrick, one of the things that he constantly called me and still calls me to this day was the hustler whenever we went in the studio, because, you know, Josh would be working on a vocal part or somebody working on a guitar part, and there I was on the telephone or I was on the laptop. I was working constantly, grinding to get the band going, because it does. It takes a lot of work to get a band exposure, to get the band known, and to get the band to make it, as, you know, quote unquote. And that's something that, you know, when we met, we all have families. Things are different than they were 10 years ago. And, you know, we got to make sure we can pay our bills. But, you know, I said, hey, guys, what do we want to do? Do we want to just be weekend pink warriors or get this thing as far as we can go? And we all agree that's where we want to go. And that's the job I got to do and plan on doing it.
Chase, what do you hope everyone takes away or message you hope they hear while listening to any of Awaken's music in general? What do you hope someone takes away from it?
I want anybody to take away, because this is stuff that I've taken away as a fan prior to joining the band. You are not alone. We are all in this together. We all go through trials. We all face our own monsters, have to deal with our own machines and our own lives. And there's a positive way to get through that. There's a good way to look. We don't have to fight negativity. We don't have to live in negativity. We can always have a positive outlook and to any situation we deal with. You're not alone. There's someone there to help. And, you know, we'll be glad to help you as well. But that's what I want people to know, is when they hear the music, we know what you've been through. We know what you're going through, because we've been there, and we want you to know that there's someone here listening and here to help.
Once everything gets back to normal and everybody gets back on to doing some tours, what can fans expect at a show from Awaken who have not got to see you guys live as of yet? What are they going to get when they come to one of your shows?
Oh, man. So, again, just joining the band as a fan prior, I can tell you what it's like when I'm on stage. You expect some craziness. I've broken basses. I'm pretty nuts when it comes to stage. And so are the rest of the guys in Awaken. Jimmy used to light his cymbals on fire. Chad is he moves a lot. Let me put it that way. The way he moves on stage is very almost cryptic. And you just can't, you're mesmerized by the way he is. So the band's always put on a phenomenal show, so I can guarantee you, when you finally get to see us live, you're going to walk away with an experience, not just a concert.
What made you want to become a musician? What was that spark for you, man, that said, I want to do this, or I even want to attempt to do it? What, if you can recall, what was it?
I didn't recall the day it happened, actually. I grew up in Florida, moved to Tennessee when I was 12. I grew up kind of like Crocodile Hunter's son. I grew up on a wildlife reserve. My dad managed a wildlife department, and I grew up dealing with dangerous animals and in the ocean, and I wanted to be a biologist, you know. Moved to Tennessee, I lost a lot of that, and went to school and became friends with some guys, and a couple of my buddies put a guitar in my hand when I was 14 years old, and I just strummed that first bit of strings and thought, this feels awesome, and it opened a door right then and there. I found out, being 14 years old, never knew this, that my father was actually in a Kiss tribute band back in the 70s. So The first guitar I got was from my father. The first songs I learned was taught to me by my father. And so that spark right there, getting that first guitar in my hand, and then something my dad supported and loved seeing me do, it was my main drive to be a musician.
You got to give me a little bit of background on this animal reserve, because I love animals, man. But let's talk about that a little bit. What type of experience was that for you?
Well, 5 years old, I'm in the back room of Silver Springs Wildlife Park in Silver Springs, Florida. Like most 5 year olds, you're probably playing in the sandbox. Not me. I'm in the reptile department room, and I've got one box full of live pinkies, which is baby mice, and I am pulling them out by their tails, popping them on the concrete, killing them. Sorry, hope don't, you know, offend anybody. And then throwing them into a bucket. And then me and my dad proceed to go take these pinkies and feed them to all the snakes in the wildlife or in the reptile department. So that was the experiences I got to have. My father was a big cave explorer. So 5 years old, 6 years old, 8 years old, we're doing caves. Actually, he helped map out Mammoth Cave up in Kentucky. So we did that one. We did several in Florida. Of course, I spent a lot of my time in the swamps, learned to snorkel at a very early age. Dealt with gators at an early age. I mean, the first gator I had to deal with was 8 years old. I've been bit by pit vipers, been bit by snapping turtles. You name it, I've been in the rough with it.
Wow.
And I absolutely love it. I love wildlife. I love everything about the outdoors. That definitely comes from my father. And so it was a great experience. My mom didn't like it, but me and my dad had a great time growing up in the swamps and in the Everglades and doing the things that we did.
So you got bit by a pit viper?
Yes, at the age of 6, got bit by a pit viper. I knew my mom was going to be so mad when she found out that I actually told her, and she hates the story, but my dad loves telling it, that I told her I didn't get bit by the snake. Mom, the snake slapped me because I didn't want her to kill the snake.
Uh-huh.
But I did end up having to go to the hospital because, I mean, I was running the fever. Of course, I was bit by a pit viper, but thank God it was actually a dry bite. So what a dry bite is it's more of a reflex where this animal is scared or just trying to get something away from it. And so instead of injecting a normal amount of venom like it would, there was pretty much no venom other than what was left residue on the fangs itself. So I was very lucky. Very lucky.
You are very, very, very lucky, dude, because when a pit viper hits you, that's it, dude. You're done. Unless you're close, very, 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 very close to the hospital, you're done.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Jeez.
So, yeah. Especially being a 6 year old. Very, very, very lucky.
Yeah.
So I've had my fair share of snake bites, but that one definitely topped them all off.
Wow. Do you think concerts and festivals will have the same impact as before with sales and attendance? Or do you think this has hurt it in the long run once all this is over?
I don't think it's hurt it in the long run. I think it's hurt it in the short run. Once concerts start to come back, I think what's going to happen is they won't be as huge in number as far as attendance because you're still going to have a few of those people that's going to be a little afraid to go out. But once everyone feels comfortable and safe, again, I'm calling this by spring or summertime, hopefully, I think you're going to see a bigger increase in concert attendance because people are going to realize how much they miss it, how much they miss living, and they want to go see a band rock it on stage.
Did you have a go-to album or maybe a song when you were younger that allowed you to escape or made you think things are going to be better or just gave you some inspiration? If so, what was it, man?
Two records, same band, Living Sacrifice's Reborn album and Living Sacrifice's Hammering Process album. Growing up as a kid, I grew up in a Christian home. I'm a Christian still. You know, my dad, we listened to a lot of classic rock albums. Actually, I still remember the first cassette tape I got on my eighth birthday from my father. Actually, I got two. I got Ozzy Osbourne's Bark at the Moon and then Blue Oyster Cult back to back. And so we're a big fan. My dad's a big Pink Floyd fan. But growing up, my mom was really not about her kids listening to that type of music. And around my early teens, I was listening to much heavier music, bands like Metallica, bands like Slayer. And my mom really wanted me to find a Christian alternative. And my father found a band called Living Sacrifice. He's like, you might like these guys. They're really heavy. They don't even sing. I was like, oh, yeah, great. That's right up my alley. And I picked up an old record of theirs called Inhabit. I loved it, but it was when they released Reborn. It changed my mind, or changed my whole life, where I realized, you know what? This is something heavy that has a very positive message. They're real in their lyrics. I can relate to what they're saying. They don't, and I don't want to bash any type of Christian band, but a lot of times in Christian music, you'll get this positive, and you need to be positive, message, but almost like cookie cutter lyrics of like, look, I understand there's a positive hope, but you know, I dealt with a drug addiction years ago, and most Christian bands can't sing about that. You know, most Christian bands can't sing about dealing with suicidal thoughts or dealing with anger in ways that we deal with. But Living Sacrifice is Reborn, and especially the Hammering Process, were the first two albums that I realized, you know what, here's somebody who has dealt with things that I've dealt with, who is real in their lyrics, and let me know that I could write music with a positive message with my experience that could change somebody's life. Hands down, Living Sacrifice, Reborn, and The Hammering Process changed my life completely with country music.
There's a punk band that I like called MXPX, and I remember a very long time ago when I turned to the Christian channel. I was just changing channels at night, you know, real late at night. And lo and behold, here's MXPX on this channel, and I'm going, that don't make no sense, because they're not, at least that I was like, they are. And I was like, well, that's pretty interesting. But there you go. You never know who's going to show up on one of those channels like that, so...
That's true. I love MXPX. Race Car Equals Race Car Backwards is a great song. Mm-hmm. I actually found them. I used to be a big fan of a band called NoFX.
Yeah.
And MXPX had done a show with them, I think, years ago. And I saw their name on a flyer. And I was like, let me look these guys up. And they were awesome. MXPX is a great band.
NoFX, Hot Dog in the Hallway, one of my favorite songs by those guys.
Oh, man. Great song.
Folks, you want to get out and pick up Awaken's new album, Monsters and Machines, once it comes out. Chase, when can we expect this album to be out possibly from you guys?
We are talking with the label right now about that. We want to get at least two, if not three more singles in. So we're looking at the possibility of an end of the year or beginning of the year release for the actual full record.
How can folks stay in touch with you guys, buy some merchandise? This album, tour dates when it all happens again, how can they do that?
Best way to do it is social media. We're on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. We've actually got a website that's going live here very soon. But, of course, we stay on our social media sites, and we interact with the fans every single chance we get. So hit us up on Facebook.com/AwakenOfficial, or you can find us under the same names. Or Instagram or Twitter.
And before I let you go, would you care to do a promo for my show?
Absolutely. This is Chase from Awaken, and you're listening to Bod's Mayhem Hour. Hey, this is Chase from Awaken, and if you're not subscribed to Bod's Mayhem Hour, make sure and go over to YouTube and subscribe right now.
Everybody stick around. We got some great stuff coming up. You only hear these interviews right here on Bod's Mayhem Hour and Bod's Mayhem Hour podcast. Please get out and check out our Facebook page. It has our podcast link and our YouTube link. And please get out and subscribe to our YouTube link, because we have a lot of stuff that's coming up and you want to subscribe to that as well. Also, get out and check out Awaken, and please pick up Monsters and Machines once it comes out. And please get out and pick up their debut single, Behemoth. You will not be disappointed. Chase, man, I wish you guys nothing but the best of luck, and you're welcome on here anytime you want.
Thanks, John. Really appreciate it.
Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.